I'd like to welcome everyone to the Thursday edition of the West Virginia Archives History Library for our lecture series that we're going to have each be back up here. This is our very first one for the year, so I'm kind of shaking up the rest here. But every month we have a lecture here in the Archives and History Library, and we'd like to invite you to look at our website, wbculture.org/history, and go to the archives portion of the website. And you'll see any of the upcoming lectures will be listed right there on our webpage. On April 20th, retired archaeologist Darla Spencer will present Native Americans in West Virginia, the Fort Ancient Culture. And there will be the upcoming lectures will be announced on our webpage. Like I said, once a month we'll be having those. Tonight, Dr. Joseph Wyatt will present The Breaking Point Killing and Other True Cases of Murder and Malice, a West Virginia Forensic Psychologist Remembers. A forensic psychologist, Wyatt has consulted on more than 900 forensic cases during his career of more than 40 years. Tonight he will highlight several local cases on which he consulted with the courts as he advised judges and juries regarding the complex matters of the minds of killers. Dr. Wyatt earned a bachelor's degree from the University of Charleston and a master's degree from the University of Miami, Florida. In 1980, he received his PhD in clinical psychology from West Virginia University. After teaching psychology at Marshall University for more than 30 years, he retired in 2014. He is also the author of several books and articles and is a contributing columnist to the Charleston Gazette-Bell. His most recent book is The Breaking Point Killing and Other True Cases of Murder and Malice, the West Virginia Forensic Psychologist Remembers. These books will be on sale after the lecture. And please welcome Dr. Joseph Wyatt.
Thank you. I am very happy to be here. I don't think I'll stand over there. Can you hear me well enough? Mm-hmm. I don't like to be the person who says, I don't need a microphone. I think you'll be able to hear me and then you can't. So I want to be sure. I am a forensic psychologist, and I'll describe a little bit about that profession and then go into a couple of cases in some detail. They're both local cases. And if you have questions along the way, please ask at any time. I'm very happy to stop for a moment and address the question. And we'll take about an hour to do that. So what I thought I would do is talk a little bit about, briefly, about what a forensic psychologist does, and I'll mention three things. There are more kinds of activities, but one of the things that I'm frequently asked to do is determine competence to stand trial. I'll get a call from a lawyer. The lawyer will say, or judge occasionally, they'll say, Dr. Wyatt, I have this defendant, and I think he's not right in the head, or there's something wrong with him mentally, or he just doesn't seem like he's got it all together intellectually or the like. So they'll ask me to examine this person, and one thing they want to know, is this person competent to stand trial? You know, in the United States of America, we don't put people on trial unless they are competent to be on trial. And what that means is that they can assist their attorney in their own defense. It means that they need to be able to understand the charges against them, and they need to understand the role of their attorney to defend them, the role of the prosecutor, the role of the judge, the jury. And I've had people say things like they think the prosecutor is there to help them. No, you know, you're a defendant in this. That's the person trying to lock you up. And they don't understand the role of the jury. they also need to know what it means if they're found guilty, or what it means if they're found not guilty. And if a person doesn't understand all those things, either maybe a very low-functioning intellectually kind of person, or maybe a person who is kind of in and out of touch with reality, psychotic, in other words, and they just can't get that information, they can't understand it. So, assuming a person is competent to go to trial, then they will, or perhaps make a plea deal. If they're not competent, what will happen is, most likely, such a person would be confined to one of the state hospitals, typically Bateman Hospital in Huntington or Sharp Hospital in Weston, until the staff there says that the person is now competent to stand trial as a result of their treatment. Now, most of the time, the people I've worked with, I tended to examine them and find they were competent. And I asked them these questions, maybe did some testing, but what do you think your lawyer's job is in the courtroom? Well, that's the one that's there to help me. Good answer. And so, now, the second question that I often ask is, this person who is said to have done this crime, was he criminally responsible at the time he did it? Meaning, did he know what he was doing? Was he psychotic or low functioning enough that he was led into this by some sharper people and they got him to steal the car, those kinds of things? And so the issue becomes one of criminal responsibility. And so there are some testing things that I would be doing. I'd also be interviewing the person extensively, of course. I would be probably talking to some collateral individuals, maybe people in his family or people who might have witnessed something or the like. Maybe getting records from his school years. Because, for example, that's important because suppose I have someone who might be faking that he is intellectually disabled, maybe pretending that he is functioning like a five-year-old or something. And, you know, one way to check for that is to go back and get his school records. And if he made pretty good progress all the way through high school, he's probably faking. And I always have to be alert for that as a forensic psychologist because it has happened. In fact, one of the cases in this book, a guy up in Fairmont had murdered four people. And he tried to convince me that he was suffering from a dissociative disorder, you know, amnesia or fugue or multiple personality, things like that. And so there are ways to catch people doing that. So I caught him. But criminal responsibility means that a person knew what he was doing, understood the requirements of the law, and he did it anyway. Now, in West Virginia, as most states, a person might be found not responsible if at the time he was out of touch with reality to the extent that he couldn't conform his actions to the requirements of the law. And there are a lot of cases like this. You'll see some high-profile cases. One of the ones that was in the news was John Hinckley, who shot Ronald Reagan. Because John Hinckley thought this would be a way to make actress Jodie Foster love him. That doesn't sound sane to me. So, it's important in any case to be aware that if you're asked by the attorney or the court, what do I look for to determine if someone was criminally responsible or not? Was there something that happened, something in his background that made him suffer a mental illness such that he really couldn't appreciate his actions as well as your own might? And there are other questions that are asked. In sometimes civil damage cases, one of which I'll talk about tonight, was a case where a guy had been wrongfully imprisoned, and then once he was exonerated, he he sued for the wrongful imprisonment. So he had, there had been a criminal case against him, a successful case. It was undone by later evidence, and he sued the state for the wrongful imprisonment. So it became a civil case. So with that as a little bit of a start, it's true that I've worked on hundreds of cases in my life, and some of them are pretty benign and not real interesting. But I picked out 11 of the cases that I felt were more interesting or unique in some way, and decided to write this book, each case being a chapter in the book, and plus a couple of general chapters about the field of forensic psychology. So, with that as a little introduction, I will talk about the first case, which happened near there. Anybody who has been down Route 60 through South Charleston, Spring Hill, Port St. Albans, you might recognize this place only because you were driving by. That certainly is my explanation. This is the story. This is a horrible story of a terrible murder. In Columbus, Ohio, a little boy grew up subject to horrible, horrible abuse. Probably the worst case of abuse and neglect I have ever seen in dealing with thousands of cases. In clinical practice, as director of our outpatient clinic at Marshall University in Huntington, and these forensic cases referred by lawyers. This boy was, his name was Bobby Love, had an older brother, 2 or 3 years older. Terrible abuse. Bobby grew up, had some criminal history. It was mostly petty and drug related. Bobby joined the Army at one point, but he was bounced out of the Army after about 18 months, most likely because of behavioral problems and psychosis. Bobby had found himself in Louisa, Kentucky, because his mother had moved there at some point. There, he became psychotic, actively raving psychotic, and had to be hospitalized. I got the records from that doctor at some point, and Bobby had been hallucinating. He heard voices telling him that he was ugly, he should hurt people, all kinds of things. And that was important history, because later, when Bobby murdered someone and I was asked to examine him to determine if he might have been psychotic when he did the murder, I knew from that history that Bobby had not just made it up on the spot exactly because he needed a mental illness defense. He was the real thing going back. So while he was in Louisa, Kentucky, another thing happened. He met a young woman named Misty Cabral. She was about 18 or 19. They began dating, and ultimately they moved to Jefferson, the community just down the road. She began work as a stripper at J.B.'s Gentleman's Club. Now, just to the right of it, about a block, is this place, the Rustic Motel. You've seen that sign. And that's where Misty and Bobby lived. And they lived in that room right there, room 127. They lived there with hopes that they could get out of there and she could get out of that job. He had some employment building modular containers or something. And they were getting along, mostly on her salary. And Bobby began to notice that she seemed to have a little more money than she might, just working as a dancer. And she was doing something else. She was taking customers from the Gentlemen's Club to their room and giving them private dances. And Bobby was a little suspicious about that, but he trusted that there was only dancing going on. He was awfully naive, of course. And so what was happening, of course, was that Misty was prostituting herself in that room. Bobby would clear out of the room and go somewhere else while the private dance took place. Along the way, Misty discovered that she was pregnant with his baby, as far as anybody knew. And Bobby was very happy. Because of his horrible childhood, he began to see that he was going to have a family and everything would be better. And so he was working to get him out of there. But he continued to be suspicious about how Misty made a little more money than he thought was reasonable by giving private dances. And on one occasion, he crept up to the window and peeked in a little bit. There was some kind of little tiny place he could see between the slats and blinds. And what he saw was Misty having sex with a customer. The customer, whose first name was Roy, came from somewhere up in Central West Virginia. Bobby, on seeing this, began to think that somehow this man was harming the fetus. Enraged and losing control of himself, he burst in the room, picked up a hammer that happened to be there, and he beat that man to death. Misty sat crying on the bed, thinking that she would be next, but no, he sent her to another room while he cleaned up this horrible mess. He went out somewhere, bought some cleaning supplies and a big plastic trash can and put the body in there, duct taped it shut, took it out behind the rustic motel and rolled it into the river, where two or three days later it was discovered by a man down there who was fishing or something. Well, it didn't take long for the police to find out who had done this, because this customer, Roy, every time he went back home to Central West Virginia, he kept a diary with meticulous details of everything that had gone on in the room. Everything. More detail than anybody would need. So when this fellow didn't any name to who it was, Misty, down at the rustic motel. And so when he didn't, when this now deceased man didn't come home, his family contacted the police after a day or two, and they found the diary and went right straight down there and arrested both of them, Misty and Bobby. Now, at that point, there was the authorities, the prosecutors began, and the police began to put a lot of pressure on Misty to tell them, to work with them and tell them that she and Bobby had planned this from the very beginning so as to rob the deceased man, and that was their plan. And in the end, they pressured her with the threat of extensive prison time if she didn't say that. And she kind of knuckled under, and she said it, even though I think she was lying. Because, why would I think she was lying?
She was pregnant.
Pardon?
She was pregnant.
Well, that was probably part of it. She didn't want to have a baby in prison. But I think she was lying because the theory of the case didn't make sense. If you have this cash cow that keeps coming back time and time again, why kill him? Just to steal whatever cash he had on him that particular day. It didn't make sense. So I never accepted her version of it, which she actually, in the beginning, said, no, we didn't have any plan to rob him. Bobby just went crazy, and this happened, and it was awful. But in time, she changed her story to avoid an extremely lengthy prison sentence. And so this whole thing played out. Bobby was convicted of first-degree murder, and he is incarcerated now at the Mount Olive prison near Montgomery, and I doubt that he'll ever get out. He might, and he's very, very old. I have a picture. There he is. Keith W. Lowe is his actual name, but for some reason everybody called him Bobby. So, it was getting time for Bobby to prepare for trial for his lawyers. And they were, I think, Gail Michelson, Zoe Shavers, and Kanawha Public Defenders. And they got in touch with me, and I examined Bobby in my office down at Marshall. Of course, he was jailed, but he was brought down there in shackles and such. So I examined Bobby, and he was cooperative, and he told me essentially what I've told you. But he also told me more, especially about his childhood. And as we talked, like I said, I think it's maybe one of the worst cases of abuse that I've ever heard in my life, abuse and neglect. And so I got permission from Bobby to talk to both his mother and his brother about it. And they confirmed every bit of it. In fact, his brother described it as worse than Bobby had. I thought I would just read a little bit of that to you. As with every individual I examined, I took an extensive history. Bobby described his childhood years in Columbus, Ohio, as full of abuse at the hands of his alcoholic father. His dad ran bars in which Bobby and his older brother Michael spent most of their time. Their father was violent, and their mother was an alcoholic, often too drunk to protect her boys from their father's abuse. When Bobby was there and was three and Michael was seven, they were made wards of the state because of the home's alcoholism and abuse. Bobby added that his awful childhood caused him to feel especially protective of his unborn baby. The sight of Roy and Misty having sex had triggered a feeling that the baby inside Misty was being harmed. For a time, Bobby and his brother shuffled among the homes of his two aunts, also into several foster homes and a facility called Buckeye Village. He never completed a full year in any one school. By the age of 11, he was doing drugs, including crack cocaine. By 12 or 13, he was selling drugs on the street to support his growing habit. At one point, he was arrested and spent 6 months in a juvenile facility. On his release, he continued using and selling drugs, and in time, he graduated to stealing cars. When he was eight, his father took custody for a while, and Bobby described his father as inhuman. His dad abused the boys with severe beatings and by having them perform oral sex on each other. He described his dad as sometimes sly about the abuse, giving them treats to get them to perform. At other times, his father was brutally violent. Bobby remembered an incident when he was so filled with fear during a vicious spanking that he urinated on his father's lap. Their dad, Harry, used cords to whip them, and if they cried, would tell them to be quiet or he'd whip them even more. An outcome of their madhouse of childhood was an important lesson. There was safety in silence. It was always wise to suppress their emotions to avoid further punishment. Bobby's father was verbally abusive as well. He called Bobby worthless and said he would never amount to anything, and the abuse never stopped. The dad treated boys the same as he treated his unruly bar customers. He threw them into the street. His father was arrested more than 20 times for assault and bragged about that. Bobby had a theory about his father's brutality. Bobby said his father was that way because Granddad was that way toward him. Now, it's always possible that someone like Bobby is making up a tale of abuse just to gain sympathy with somebody like me. So I call Bobby's brother Michael. During the conversation, Michael revealed that the degradation and physical violence of their childhoods was even worse than Bobby had described it. At one point, the brothers were with a certain sitter for 2 or 3 years, Michael said. Michael was certain that Bobby had been sexually molested there, although Michael had not. The boys bounced from one place to another. You were never sure what was home, who was your mom, who was your dad, Michael said. At some point, Michael moved away. Got a girlfriend, moved away, and on and on it goes with a horrible, horrible situation. And when I talked to Bobby's mother, she said the same thing. She was still living in Louisa, Kentucky. Interestingly, when I talked to them, I said, you know, probably your testimony would be beneficial to Bobby at trial, and they both refused to testify. Michael said that he had gotten past all this, was married, doing well enough in somewhere in the Carolinas, and he just, it was too painful to reopen all these memories. His mother said she was afraid she would say things that would actually hurt Bobby's case, although it's hard to imagine how. So neither testified at trial. Anyway, Bobby was convicted of first-degree murder. That is a life sentence in West Virginia. So this was a terrible case. My part of it, after I examined Bobby and did some testing, there are actually some psychological tests that can catch people. It's paper and pencil tests that can catch people if they are faking a mental illness. And Bobby was not faking. Plus, all this other history I obtained suggested that he wasn't faking. And particularly his history of psychosis a year or so before in Kentucky. So I rendered my report, and I said that I thought at the time of this horrible murder that Bobby had essentially decompensated, become psychotic briefly, and couldn't have conformed his actions to the requirements of the law. Obviously, that didn't do him as much good as he would have liked, for probably this reason. Many people, do you know what happens if somebody is found not guilty by reason of insanity? Anybody know? Well, many people, especially people who are on juries, tend to think that if I find not guilty by reason of insanity, we find that, I might bump into this guy walking down the street tomorrow. I don't want him in my community. When actually, nothing could be further from the truth. In such a case, a person goes to trial, is found not guilty by reason of insanity, a judge will order that person locked up in a secure facility in West Virginia, Sharp Hospital up in Weston. And that person is not getting out until such time as the staff there says that the person now has become sane enough to release to the community. And I can just tell you, that is never in a month or a year. It's years and years and years and years. In fact, at some point years ago, we had to establish a law that if a person had committed a crime, not murder, which is the life sentence, but let's say some robbery or assault, they could not be held at the Sharp Hospital if they had been found not guilty by reason of insanity any longer than if they had been found guilty of the crime and sentenced to jail, to prison, because people were being found guilty of a crime or not guilty of by reason of insanity in a matter that maybe the maximum sentence would have been, let's say, 10 years, and they got sent to a secure forensic facility, and they were still there 15 years later. You know, so the law was changed.
Are the jurors not informed what
actually,
that, what
no.
Really?
It's actually illegal for a defense attorney to say to a jury, now, if you find not guilty by reason of insanity, he's not going to be walking free. They can't, you know, in the trial, the issue is guilt or innocence. Nothing about potential penalties can be said. Hmm. This is a good question.
That's interesting. I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there have been mistrials that occurred because, you know, an attorney, typically a defense attorney, slipped and said something about the potential penalties. Nice question. Who else has a question? Yes.
First of all, why were you called in on the case? Was it the defense that requested you?
Yes, because his lawyers knew that Bobby had this history of psychosis, and they knew that what had happened was a pretty rash act at the time of his homicide. And they knew that the physical evidence against Bobby was overwhelming, so if they didn't raise a mental illness defense, he was just going to be found guilty of first-degree murder anyway. So that was sort of the defense trying hope against hope that maybe a mental illness defense would help. And there's another reason to do it, which is even in some cases, even if the lawyers think, well, the mental illness defense is probably not going to work, but they want a clinical psychological evaluation because they might introduce that and use it at sentencing to get a more favorable sentence. A good idea of that, there was a fellow down in, this case is also in this book, he was down in Princeton, a very successful realtor, former school teacher who over the years of his teaching developed a realty business on the side, and then quit teaching school to go full-time and very successful. And he became psychotic after falling for one of these scams where he got a fax saying that he had inherited $15 million from a long-lost relative in Africa somewhere. Why a smart person falls for that, I don't know. Although I can tell you, several times I have inherited millions of dollars from long-lost relatives. But he took that bait, ended up killing his partner in a complete episode of psychosis. And when I examined him, he was transferred down to River Park Hospital in Huntington, where I was working part-time. And you know, my report, I just said he was clearly psychotic when this happened. The details would convince any of us. And so his lawyer did a real nice job. He never went to trial, but using my report to get the judge to give him a pretty favorable sentence because the man would have had no chance of it, not out of prison. He was in his mid-50s, not big and strong, you get the idea. And so he would have probably been murdered there. And so he got an alternative location for his sentence. There are other places. They are, some of them are old county jails that have been taken over by the State Department of Correction for just such cases, and for transition of about all of people out to the community. They can start by going to an old county jail. So he did that. And that guy's, that case was 15 or so years ago, maybe 20. He's about scheduled to be out. Other questions? Those are nice questions. Well, that was the case of Bobby Lowe. A horrible, horrible case. And there's one little bit of follow-up. A few years back, that case took place in, began in 2003 was when the homicide took place. A few years ago, maybe 5 years ago, Bobby and two other men tried to escape from Mount Olive Prison. I have been up there voluntarily. Anybody here in the room, have you been up to Mount Olive Prison? Well, there is nobody getting out of there. I just can't imagine. And there's the inner area of the prison and then an outer area. And these three guys got loose from their bed check and they were in the outer area, but they hadn't got over the fence. I mean, there's concertina wire. And it took maybe half hour to catch them in there after a bed check. So I don't think Bobby's going to get out of there. Maybe when he's very, very old. Any other questions? If you look at another case, would you like to see it? Does anybody know that guy? President? Ring a bell?
Oh, yeah.
My wife and I, Barbara's here with me tonight. We used to know Fred. Fred Zane passed away. Barbara was the cup pack master, mistress, when our little boy was in cups. And when he grew out of it, Fred Zane took over. And so we knew Fred a little bit. Fred was, anybody doesn't know, especially younger people in the audience, Fred was a state policeman, technically. He was a serologist, a chemist, who worked down in South Charleston at the state police lab down there by Bob Evans, the street there. And so he was not out there on the road arresting people. Fred was looking at slides of blood, semen, and tissue and things under a microscope, and then going to court, testifying if it matched the defendant and so on. Well, and here's a better picture of Fred. Anyway, anybody here from Cross Lanes? How that good?
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, back in 1989, anybody there in 1989 might remember there was a horrible murder. A man named Jim Richardson woke up one night and he heard some noise out behind his house, and he thought somebody was out there messing with an old car that he had out there to work on. And so he went out to see what it was, and actually it wasn't that. The neighbor up behind him, her house was on fire. And he knew that this was a single parent of a little 2 or 3 year old toddler. So he ran up there, Jim Richardson ran up there, and he ran in the house, which was already pretty consumed with fire and smoke. And he found that baby and got it out, and he tried to go back in, and he just couldn't. It was too dangerous, too full of smoke and fire. And it wouldn't have mattered anyway, because the woman was already there dead inside. She had been raped and murdered. And then someone had set the fire to cover the tracks. Remember that case? So, initially, Jim Richardson was hailed as a hero for saving the baby, but after 3 or 4 days, the police began to look at Jim Richardson with a jaundiced eye, because, and Jim Richardson was, I think how old, he was about 30, early 30s maybe at that point, and this was again all in 1989. When he was a very young man, maybe 18, 19, 20, he and another old boy had got drunk and convinced themselves that some neighbor lady had enormous wealth and riches stashed away in her house. And they broke in there trying to steal something. They didn't hurt her or anything. But they were trying to find this wealth. There wasn't anything in there. Value. And the woman wasn't hurt. So, but they had to face the music. And Jim was sent to one of the youth correctional places for a few months, I think, maybe just a couple of months, I've forgotten now. But because of that history some years before, and after that, Jim had straightened up and he'd been an okay citizen and was married, had a son, a young son, but the police began to look at him and decided that he must have done this crime himself. And so he said, "This is preposterous, I didn't do this." But he went to trial and was found guilty of first-degree murder and sentenced to prison, where he went up to Mount Olive Prison, the old prison. There's Jim Richardson, and that's the house there behind it, set out of the way, so you can see that a little better. So he was sentenced, went to trial, claiming his innocence, was sentenced, and he ended up going to prison for more than 8 years. Most of that time, about maybe 6 or 7 years of it, were at the old prison in Moundsville. There it is. Isn't that exactly where you want to spend 8 years? And then the last year or two, there's inside of Moundsville prison. Not very enticing. And then he went to the new prison up at Mount Olive near Montgomery. So there he was, always proclaiming his innocence. And it was horrible because he was innocent, for one thing. And having the community think of him as a murderer and rapist, well, that's not good. Losing your liberty, pretty stressful. the conditions of prison, horrible, absolutely horrible. So, along this time, sometime after, down in Huntington, remember the case of the Huntington Mall rapist? A man said to be Glendale Woodall, who wasn't the Huntington Mall rapist, who also went to prison. There were some things in common with these two cases. Fred Zane had gone to the witness stand in these cases and lied about his findings. In the case of Jim Richardson, Fred Zane had gone on the witness stand and said that the semen from the deceased woman in Crosslands could only have come from 1% of the male population, and Jim Richardson was in that 1%. You think the jury needed to hear anything else? Nope. And in the Huntington case of Glendale Woodall, a judge down there, Dan O'Hanlon, longtime circuit judge, he was the first state-level judge in America to allow DNA evidence to be presented in court. Anybody, did you know that? That's pretty interesting. And it exonerated Glendale Woodall. He was not the Huntington Mall rapist. And, like a row of dominoes, several other cases, in fact, many, many of them, in which Fred Zane had testified, were re-examined. In fact, a retired Putnam County judge, Judge Holliday, who, by the way, is the father of Marshall's football coach. And there's no extra charge for that sort of trivia. He was assigned by the state Supreme Court to go back and review all these cases in which Fred Zane testified. And his report concluded, his staff concluded that any case that Fred had ever testified in should not be treated as a valid result. So Jim Richardson from Cross Lanes up at Moundsville Prison, then at Mount Olive, said, what about me? And his lawyers got DNA evidence. And also re-examination of the original evidence that Fred Zane had looked at, the serology evidence. And they found two things. Number one, there was not a match with Jim Richardson. And number two, when Fred Zane had said about the original serology evidence that this could only match 1% of the male population of the world, and Jim Richardson was in that 1%, that was completely bogus. As it turned out, that serology could not eliminate any male from consideration of having done that crime, much less eliminate 99% of them, couldn't eliminate any of them. So translation, Fred Zane's serology evidence, if he had told the truth, was completely useless as evidence. Except maybe to put questions in the jury's minds. But now, you know, this was such a tragedy. So Jim Richardson was released from prison. Remember, I had three different kinds of things in cases, and I mentioned a civil case. So Jim Richardson got out of prison. There he is. He remarried, had a little baby, getting along with his life again. He was, by this time, in his late 40s and mid-40s, maybe. And was getting along okay, had employment. He sued the state. He sued the state police because their agent, Fred Zane, had cost him 8.5 years out of his life, cost him his marriage, 8.5 years to be a father to his son, cost him esteem in the community. Some people probably still believe that he did this crime. It cost him a lot. So his lawyer, in the civil case against both the state and also the Kanawha County Commission, since Kanawha County's prosecutor, put him on trial, and made use of faulty evidence. He sued them both. Now, that is the kind of case that I felt would never go to trial. The state's Bureau of Insurance and Risk, Bureau of Risk and Insurance Management, BRIM, has a, at that time anyway, in fact, a $1 million cap on any payout. And I felt like what they would do was just give him $1 million in each case rather than go to trial and have the expense of a trial and then have to give it to him. And that's exactly what happened, which helped Jim Richardson reestablish his life. But anyway, before that settlement, his lawyer asked me to examine Jim Richardson. They needed an expert witness to go to court and talk about the stress, the psychological, emotional, etc. Issues that Jim Richardson has been through in all this, because emotional, psychological damages are a form of damages for which a person may sue. So Jim Richardson came to my office in Marshall, at Marshall, and I examined him, did some testing, and interviewed him, and so on. And he was really surprisingly without, seemingly without anger or hostility toward Fred Zane or anybody else. I mean, I think he had just come to grips with the fact that, you know, you don't, your life doesn't go on forever, so he wanted to make the most of it. But he did need to sue the state and try to make up economically for what he lost. So he talked to me about the rigors of prison. It's pretty educational for me, I mean, you can imagine. But he said things like, you know, the constant tension of always having to watch your back. Because people do come to harm in prison. And in Moundsville, there have been a number of murders in there. The old Moundsville prison, there might have been a couple at Mount Olive, but I think it's a little more secure. But he talked about other things. He talked to, Jim said, he said, you know, just the business, particularly in the old Moundsville prison, it was so awful. You know, it's filthy. And the racket, he said, it was screaming and yelling all night long. And it's boiling hot in the summer and freezing cold in the winter. And I actually went back and I found a report. At one point, after there had been a series of some murders and other kinds of things at the old Moundsville prison, the state Supreme Court assigned an attorney to investigate the whole place. And that attorney spent days and days up there over a period of, I don't know, a year or so, I guess. And in his report, which I referred to, he talked about just himself being in the cafeteria and maggots dropping out of the ceiling into somebody's plate. He saw rats running, and he saw in the cold weather toilets, he couldn't flush them because they were frozen with ice. And in the hot weather, 110 degrees or something, I mean, just horrible. So I knew that Jim Richardson had been through a lot. Just the fact that he lost his liberty, lost his family, was thought of in the community as a rapist and murderer, and then all the rigors of being in prison. So I wrote my report, sent it up to his lawyer, and said, you know, he's actually doing pretty well now, but that was hell on earth. That's all you can say about it, for especially a guy knowing that he was innocent. And his lawyer then used the report, and Jim settled with the state for the maximum it could pay in the county, which was a total of $2 million, and he got on with his life. But I always wondered something about Jim Richardson. I never saw him again, but I wondered, all that stress, what did it do, not just do to him mentally, because he seemed like he was getting along pretty well, although while he, before he was exonerated and got out, it was horrible. But, you know, that's the kind of stress that can kill a person. And one day I picked up my Charleston newspaper, and at the age of 54, Jim Richardson had died of heart attack, so enough would have happened anyway, but it might have. So, a terrible, terrible case, and a little bit more, you know, the psychology here doesn't stop with Jim Richardson. Part of it goes to Fred Zane and what was going on in his head, doesn't it? And, you know, as much as we knew Fred, I always saw Fred as, you know, a little bit arrogant, and I began to think maybe he kind of liked being on the stand, being the star of the show or something, and I believe that probably was a part of it. You know, even though he was a chemist, when he went on the stand, he wore a state police uniform, gun holster belt, and all that. He seemed a little cocky or something. But I found out a little bit more as I researched all this in this book. After Fred left Kanawha County and went to Bexar County, Texas, which is the county where San Antonio and the Alamo are located, and he began doing the same work for the county there, that was when all of this was discovered back home in West Virginia. But a few years went by while he was still working down there. And interestingly enough, of course, when Fred went down there, there were cases on which he had worked back in West Virginia that he was called back to provide testimony. Makes sense. And he charged $500 plus expenses to do that, which in those days, was, even today, would be okay money. But this is something that I find particularly galling. Kanawha County prosecutors and some others around the state, as new cases arose, cases Fred had never been involved in, he was in Texas by now, they would have the chemists and serologists down there at the police lab would do analyses, and the results would come back not a match with the defendant. You know what they would do? They would gather those samples, send them to Fred in Texas for a reanalysis, and wouldn't you just know, Fred's report came back and said, yeah, this matches the defendant. And Fred would be brought back here at $500. To provide that testimony, which convicted a number of people.
And no one ever got slapped on the hand for that either.
And you're right. As far as the prosecuting attorneys, et cetera, anybody like that around here, there should have been some very negative consequences.
And in Texas, they didn't get slapped on the hand there either.
What they did in Texas, actually, of course, they discovered what was going on. And he left Texas, and the tragedy of Fred Zane, He was working, not in the police or law enforcement field, but Fred was working as a county health inspector or something like that in Florida. Some of the people in West Virginia filed lawsuits against him personally, and he was brought back to West Virginia for trial, for basically just lying them into prison. And there was a change of venue from Charleston to Beckley, and Fred went to trial. He claimed that this was all just political stuff against him, and he was found not guilty. And that was for lying on the witness stand. So he goes back to Florida, and he was brought up on additional charges of taking money under false pretenses, the $500 every time he came back. And before that could go to trial, Fred died of colon cancer.
How many cases actually ended up affected by this?
There were hundreds of cases in which he testified, of course. Judge Holliday's commission, special commission, I think they investigated something like 150 of them. And, you know, of course, some cases there is other evidence. You didn't really need Fred Zane. Two or three eyewitnesses said, I was there and saw him shoot that guy. So those cases were not real. It's the ones where Fred's testimony was seen as the critical feature of the case. And there were, I believe, eight people who were exonerated.
Second portion, in your opinion, how much of this on Fred Zane's part was incompetence and how much was arrogance?
I think it was all arrogance. And the reason I say that, two of his lab assistants down in South Charleston, before all this came out, wrote a letter to the superintendent of state police. And I've documented this in the book. And one of them's name was Midkiff, and the other I forgot. And they wrote a letter saying, Fred Zink, we've seen this with our eyes. He is writing reports of serology findings when he didn't even examine the slide. You know, you got to look in a microscope and see what the thing's looking back at. And the superintendent of the state police later questioned about that, said, well, he didn't have any letter like that. They kept copying. And that he did remember there was some kind of office infighting down there, but that's all.
So, who was the superintendent?
You know, I forgot. The name is in there. It's a lot of secret. Good questions.
George Castell was one of the public defenders that worked on some of those cases.
George Castell, who just retired a couple of years ago, I think, as the director of the Kanawha Public Defender's Office, fine lawyer, fine man, and I've worked with George on some other cases, and some of his staff, and he really dug into that. And I said, you worked there at the Public Defender's Office. We are at the end of our hour. I would be happy to linger for a few minutes and chat informally, but I don't like to keep people in their seats any longer than they were promised. So with that, I think I'll close the formal part of this program and be happy to remain up here and chat a little bit more. And if anybody cares to buy the book, it's $16. So there you go. Thank you very much for your attention.